Talk than you've heard before. Sorry about that. So I'm going to tell you a true story about tech on macOS 10, but at the blood and gore of this story might be interest you even if you don't have a Mac. So it's a story with heroes, and the heroes are Gerben Wirde and Jerome Lawrence. To add a little pizzazz to things, Jerome Lawrence is my competitor, so I have a front end called Tech Shop. He has a front end called iTech Mac. So when I talk about his name, you will see this little edge. Okay, and then this story has a villain also, and that would be me. Okay, so here's the story. Last year, at this time, the situation in the math world was wonderful. There was a single distribution based on T-Tech by Gerben Wirde. Everybody used it. So all of the front ends and utilities knew that people would have that front end, so they were pointed to that. And that meant that everything just worked right out of the box. You install tech, install a front end, clung, it works. No preferences, swell. And then something happened in May 2006. And what happened was that Thomas Esser announced that he was ceasing support of T-Tech. And the effect in the Mac world was a big yawn, because we didn't read the T-Tech site, and Gerben would take care of it, right? Gerben does everything. So we were relaxed. So the next event happened in Marrakesh at a tech meeting, and it was the release by Gerben Wirde. I should mention that Thomas Esser suggested that people move to Tech Live. So in Marrakesh, there was the release by Gerben Wirde of a new tech called GW Tech based on Tech Live. So we had made it. I think Gerben was one of the first people to make that transition. But mysteriously, he also announced at exactly the same meeting that he was ceasing support of all this stuff. It's like, in June, Apple would release this iPod and announce that they were ceasing support for the thing. And he added a dialogue to iInstaller to install it. And it said, dialogue, this is unsupported. Now, everybody in this room seem to be developers, so they would be relaxed. But I can tell you that that panicked our users. So on the mailing list, suddenly there was a commotion, and it was like this. Does this mean that it's the end of tech on macOS 10? So I was one of the panicked people, and I decided that I needed to look at Tech Live. I knew very well that Tech Live was a really nerdy system, and the install script would ask me, does your BSD compiler require distributed or shared libraries? But I went and got the DVD and tried it out. Well, the install script just asked about three questions, and they were completely straightforward, and it went zip, and I had it, and it worked. So you would think that I would be very happy with Carl Berry, but actually I got very, very annoyed because because of the guy's modesty. So I talked to this guy for a long time. He never said to me, why don't you Mac guys use Tech Live? So in the write-up of this talk, I compare him to Maxwell, who had exactly the same problem. And so people didn't pay attention to his theory of electricity and magnetism for a long time. So all right, there's my dig at Carl. So the current situation on the Mac is that we have three distributions, all based on Tech Live, and you'll see in a minute why there are three major distributions. The first one, Mac people may not have heard of, it's Basic Tech, and it's for people with a very slow download, and it contains about 40 megs of stuff, but it's amazing what it can do. It has AMS Tech, AMS LaTeX, it has Context, ZTeX is in there. All my stuff goes through this. So somebody has a slow download speed, they have that. And then we have Gerben's stuff. Gerben's GW, incidentally, as I predicted, Gerben couldn't let go. And so he is still upgrading. It's just that he doesn't use email. But Donald Knuth doesn't use email. What's the big deal? So we have a one-button install package that installs Gerben's GWTAC, and then you can maintain it with iInstaller. Incidentally, this one-button, all of these packages, one-button install packages, were written by Jonathan Q overnight from 8 in the until 8 in the morning. And then the final package is the one I'd really promote, and it's just TechLive, the whole thing, the whole hog. Because let's face it, we're tech people, and tech is small potatoes now. It doesn't take up hardly any disk space. Unless you guys are making movies, you're not part of the main part of the world. Okay, so there are the things. For most people, the whole shooting match, and then we have these other packages as well. Incidentally, people always believe that since this comes in a Mac install package, we must have munged it somewhere. It's not really TechLive. It's Mac people are as fiddling. Wrong. It's TechLive. Everything unmodified. And I should mention that there are other distributions as well. Gabe Gerben's original distribution is still around and still being used, and there are TTEC distributions also in Fink and Mac ports. So I count 6 distributions on the Mac. And there's one other thing you might like to know. These distributions go in different spots. So you don't ever have to worry about installing this will ruin this. They all install differently. I know you're worried about taking up all that space, but I just told you, you have plenty of space. Okay. So there are different spots that all this stuff is taken care of. So I'm trying to feed you what I claim is good news. But if you're a Mac person, you're not buying it. You're saying 6 different distributions. Oh my God, why don't you people get your act together? So let me see if I can tell you some stories. Here's the first story. A month ago, a U of O physics student called me. He wrote me email. And he said, I just switched from Windows to Mac, and I set around off Saturday to put software on my machine. And so he installed Mac Tech because he wanted tech. And then he went to his lab buddies, and they told him to get other Unix utilities. He needed Fink. So he installed Fink. And Fink said, okay, here I am. Now I can get other stuff for you. What do you want? And he said, give me everything. So then he got TTEC. He didn't know it, but he got it. And then one of his friends said, you know, to learn tech, it would be easier to use Lynx. So he got Lynx. And Lynx said, well, I'm having a problem. I need to install the style files in GWTEC, but you don't have it. So he got GWTEC. So one day, 3 complete tech distributions. And then he read the Fink site, and it told him how to reconfigure TechShop to use TTEC, but he'd never heard of TTEC. So then he wrote me. So maybe the situation in our world is not so good. Now, there's another thing I want to talk about, and it's the matter of upgrading TechLive. It's sort of depends on what you do. So if you use context, you have to upgrade every week, because this guy just, I mean, if he takes off a week, he must be visited by the devil or something. But my friends work in the tech world with mathematics, and they behave completely differently. They don't know about this conference. And what happens to them when you say, you know, there's a new version of all this stuff is, oh my God, I have 2 books I'm working on. I have 5 joint papers. Don't talk to me about it now. And the people who belong to this organization, they get this DVD, they say, I'm sure not going to upgrade now. It probably wouldn't work. I'd put it away and forget it. So the trouble is that people who use tech sometimes are really, really afraid to upgrade. So here's the basic question. How do you switch from one distribution to another? They don't interfere with each other, but what do you do if you switch? Well, let me tell you what these various distributions say to do. Fink and Mac ports say, it's easy, you just modify your path variable. But Mac users often have never even heard of path. TechLive gives the same advice, ditto. So Gerben and also the Mac people are say the users, you need to modify your path and your man path and TechShop preferences and iTech Mac preferences and LaTeX preferences, and BibTeX preferences, and a heck of a lot of other GUI preferences. And then there's one other thing, if you forget something. So what's the danger? So I have a distribution I'm using, and suddenly I hear 6 months from now, there's a way to modify this from the command line. So I've never used the command line, but I try it, and I do this modification, and zip, it's done. And then I run TechShop, and the modification didn't take, because the command line was looking at one distribution, but TechLive, and what are the chances that I can fix that or figure out what happened? Okay, so now I'm delighted to tell you that the heroes of this story have a solution to that problem. And I'm going to show you their solution. So open recent, I'm going to open this document that I wrote about the lemniscate and the elliptic functions. That's a really wonderful topic, but I can't tell about it. And I'm going to typeset that document. And actually, you can't see the slides, which is wonderful. I can pull off. If this doesn't work, you'll never know. And right here it says, I just used TechLive. Okay, so now, here's their solution. Here's the preferences for the Apple system. All the Mac people will be familiar. And right here, there's a new preference pane, written incidentally by my competitor, called the Tech Distribution Pane. And it just lists all the distributions that I have right there. So why don't I switch to Fink? And I have to type a password, which half of my colleagues say at that point that's too hard for them. They forgot the password. But otherwise, okay, and now I'm done and I'm going to typeset. And typeset fine. And right there, software, share, tech, it used Fink. Would you notice that I didn't stop my program? I didn't even reload the file. It just worked. So what does this preference change? Incidentally, I had nothing to do with this. What does this preference change? It changes your shell. It changes your man path. It changes TechShop preferences. It changes iTechMac preferences. It changes BibTeX desk preferences. It changes everything, all with this one little click. Right? I mean, it's a miracle. So how did all this happen? Well, let's see if I can give you a feel for how it happened. Let's see. I actually think that I'm responsible for starting things. When I made a MacTech package based on TechLive, I decided to put an extra link called User Local Tech Programs, which would point to the binaries of the distribution I just installed. And then the idea is that the GUI apps could just use that rather than the actual location, and they'd never have to be reconfigured again. Okay, and then I asked Gerben to support this idea in his packages. And I stole this idea, but let's not get into that. So Gerben's response was no response for about 2 weeks, and then the Europeans always generalize. They never seem to just... So he immediately thought of a generalization. The generalization is, I'm interested in lots of things. I might want to know where the binaries are. if I'm going to modify shell, I need to know where the man. I might need to know where the man pages are. Might be useful to, for GUIs to know where the documentation folders are. If I'm going to install some stuff in the distribution, I'd like to know where the tech modify trees are. So why don't we give them everything, not just this where the binaries are, but everything. So the idea is really, really simple. We'll put an extra folder somewhere else, which will be called distributions, and it'll contain folders for every one of the installed distributions. And every one of those folders will just contain some links to the important information for that distribution. So for example, the little extra folder we create for TechLive 2000 will have links to the Intel binaries and a link to the PowerPC binaries. They might actually be the same if they're universal binaries, but otherwise different places, a link to the man pages, a link to the documentation in the various trees, so that GUI could find things immediately. It knows what the distributions are. And then there would be one extra symbolic link called default tech, which would point to the folder of the active distribution. That's the idea, right? Really easy. Really easy. Now let me tell you some final reassuring things, and then I'm going to go into the sorted part of the story. Hanging data doesn't create any problems. This preference pane is really smart, and it says, okay, here's the link. Gosh, it doesn't point to anything. That distribution is not installed. So removing a distribution, you don't have to worry about this extra data structure at all. It'll just hanging links, no problem. I mean, you might want to get rid of a distribution if you need an extra gig, but I don't think you want to get rid of the extra 2K. Both Gerben and I installed this data structure in all our packages, and we're completely compatible. We also installed the data structure for old distributions before it was invented. So the system recognizes Fink, it recognizes Mac ports, it recognizes old years TechLive. And finally, one thing, it's actually better to install TechLive with our system install package than from the script, because then we'll install this data structure, then we'll automatically fix your path, we'll automatically choose your paper size correctly, so just some extra details are taken care of. So now tell me, isn't this wonderful? So now, what was my reaction to all this? Well, I wrote a series of emails to Gerben about it, and they were more and more vitriolic. And after a while, I started to complaining to other people. I don't want to reveal my vitriolic email to Gerben, but I'm going to pick one of the emails, which was an email to Jonathan. And I'll just sort of read it. I shouldn't be writing you, but I need to kvetch to somebody. I think Gerben's design is a mess. I support his basic idea, but he's lost all sense of proportion. What am I expected to do with this broke design? Am I taking this too personally? Do I need to get alive? Jonathan didn't answer that either. Actually, I sent a sort of copy to Carl, and he very politely told me, without responding to the email, that I did need to get alive. So what I want to do now, and I confess that I was wrong, is to show you Gerben's actual data. So that's what I'm going to do. So let's see if I'm going to quit all this stuff, and I'm going to save. I don't know why it asked me to do that. And I'm going to show you the data. That means that I have to pretend that I know how to use Terminal. So here's Terminal, and you know, I'm going to increase the size of Terminal so you can see it, like that. So, how's that? And change directory to library tech distributions. So that's where Gerben keeps his stuff. How am I doing on time? That's okay. So list. And sure enough, exactly what I told you would happen happened. Here are these folders describing the various distributions on this map. There is one mysterious thing. The distributions have the folders have an extension, doc.tekdist. Remember that. But that's minor. So let me show you one of them, and I'll show you TechLive. We're a sort of TechLive group here. .tekdist. So now you're going to see the links. List. Well, no. You see a directory called contents. Huh? Let me list long. It's off the screen. Well, contents is really a link. And it's a link to something that's hidden. What? I'm beginning to get angry all over again. So let me list all in that directory. Yeah, sure enough, there's some hidden stuff. There's default tech. That's the thing that tells you what tech is active. It's hidden. Why did Gerben do that? And then there's extra factory defaults. What the devil? So change directory dot factory defaults. I may not be able to finish this talk. List. Well, like, there the directories all are repeated, but without the tech dist. What the? What? And so change directory tech live. Wouldn't you write fancy email? List. Contents. Damn. Change directory contents. List. List long. Yay! There are the links. But there are these relative links. Well, let me first confess that Gerben knew what he was doing. He was worried that your distribution might be on a second disk. That's why the links are relative. But what is all this extra tech dist, contents, hidden stuff? So, ladies and gentlemen, on the Macintosh, it is possible to have a folder which the system can be tricked into showing as just a file. And most programs are like that. So for example, Mathematica is just one icon, you drag it wherever you want, and so on. But if you're in the know, you can open that up and look inside, and Mathematica is really a giant folder. And it has the binaries, and it has lots of RTF files and lots of text files. It even has text style files in Mathematica. So how do you make one of these tricky folders? The answer is that you give it an extension, like, for example, .tekdist. And then inside you have to have a subfolder named contents. So what that means is that Gerben had created a series of tricky folders. So let me change directory, library, tech, distributions again. And then let me try a trick that I was taught by Jonathan. There's the Macintosh view of these places where all the links are. I want you to notice that on my computer, they're folders. But they're the kind of tricky folder that could become just an icon. Now, how do you make it in an icon? Well, an application has to claim it. An application has to say, yeah, I know all about these tech disks. And then every one of these will miraculously get an icon, and I don't know why you'd want that to happen, but. So I wrote Gerben and I said, what is the application that's going to claim these distributions? And Gerben said, I don't know, I'm just the designer of the data structure. But then I had a thought. I bet it's my rifle. iTech Mac is going to claim this. Gerben and Jerome are both in Europe. These Europeans are going to pull the tech rod right from out underneath me. Okay, so I wrote my final angry email after doing an experiment with TechShop, and I said, hooray for me, I just added a line of code to TechShop, and now TechShop claimed. And then I said, but no front end should do that, and I just can't figure out why you guys don't see that. So this is the end of the story. The next day, I got an email from Jerome, and he said, did you know that the University of Oregon is blocking my email? I've been trying to write you for the last 2 weeks, and it's always bounced back. And then Jerome said, I completely agree with you. Front end shouldn't capture this stuff. And then he said, by the way, I have a preference pane, and users will be able to change just by clicking like so. And finally, he said, it is true that I did write another little program to capture these things, but all it does is that when you click on one of these because you somehow got into this, it pulls up my preference pane. So I'm trying to tell you a moral story. And here's the moral. There aren't nearly as many evil people in the world as you think there are. And you can learn a lot, even from your competitors.
Thank you.